Welcome to Fresh Outlook. I'm Frank Cipolla. Another week, another Republican presidential debate. This latest edition included those vying for the nomination stepping up their attacks on each other. One of the main topics, immigration, another the problems in the Middle East. On hand to give us their take of who won, who lost, and what happens next is David Goodman. He's from Represent Us. Jordan Goodman, no relation, is America's Money Answers man. And Jim McCarthy is right there in the middle. He is a financial planner and owner of Directional Wealth Management. Gentlemen, welcome.
Did you
see the debate? I'm sure you all did.
Oh, sure.
The candidates seem to be attacking each other as we get closer to the primary. What do you make of that?
Well, on economic grounds, they have a very, very different view of the Democrats. Basically, they want to cut spending. They want to cut regulation. And just basically roll back everything that's happened the last 7 years.
Right.
The Democrats want to do more of what they've done the last 7 years. Higher taxes. They want to have more free programs. Bernie Sanders wants free college for everybody, so goodies for all, and higher taxes, basically. So they have a completely, almost doesn't matter which one they are, completely different views of the world and how to go forward.
Now, you've talked to me before about how much money plays a part in the campaign.
Sure, and the winner, Frank, in this debate so far are the super PACs.
Why do you say that?
Well, here we are. We're at the end of the year. We're weeks away from the Iowa caucuses and the New Hampshire vote, and we still have a full stage of, what do we have, 8 or 9 on the prime time and 3 in the on the undercard?
Right.
I mean, we're talking about a dozen candidates. The oxygen that's keeping them alive is the money. I mean, at this point, the field should have narrowed down. All we've seen is Scott Walker, Rick Perry, and Bobby Jindal drop out. Polling that the candidates are doing, this field should be narrowing, but what we have is an artificial situation where money is keeping these people active.
Well, there's two ways to look at this. I don't remember a presidential campaign in recent memory where we had this many candidates, number one. Number two, people are always saying, I would like more choice. So here we have a bunch of candidates. Which is better, fewer or more?
Well, I'm not sure. I think fewer is better. I mean, it makes it a little bit easier. You can start to narrow down and get some real policies rather than the bickering that's going on between the two.
Right.
And to your point, I mean, I think the money's not only the super PACs. I think the money's with the media, and we're on media.
Right.
But, I mean, you know, you wouldn't have the undercard and the prime time debates if there wasn't enough viewership for CNN or whomever.
And the irony is that Trump is not spending any money whatsoever.
Right. Right.
He's got free TV.
He's asking for money. Didn't he ask CNN for money to be on?
A little bit. But, well, I mean, basically, he's doing a totally publicity-oriented campaign without buying ads or anything like that. So that's the irony. All the other candidates that are losing, getting the money, the guy with all the money has no
I'll tell you, the Republicans are panicked for several reasons, but one of which is they fear we may have a brokered convention come this summer. I mean, the last brokered convention was when Ford and Reagan challenged each other. Nobody was happy with that outcome.
Right.
You could have one winner in Iowa. Right now, it appears that Cruz is heading in that direction. It's up for grabs in New Hampshire. I'm not sure that Trump will win it, but we've got Chris Christie nipping at his heels.
Right.
And South Carolina could be a third victory.
Right.
The point of it is we could head through the spring, through Super Tuesday, and into the summer without any candidate accumulating the necessary delegates to claim victory. And that could be a disaster for the political parties who really favor control. They want to control the outcome,
right.
And the Republicans, frankly, the establishment, is even though the chairman is giving a sunny picture of everything,
mm-hmm.
they're in a panic. I mean, earlier this month, Christine Todd Whitman, who's the former governor of New Jersey, could not be, there's not a person who could be more establishment than she. She wrote a piece in Politico entitled, Republicans Must Defeat Trump Now.
Mm-hmm.
She called him, and I think by implication, Ted Cruz, a Hitler and Mussolini. I said this
right.
on this broadcast a few weeks ago. She said that they are demonizing first Mexicans and now Muslims. I mean, there's really a fear within the Republican establishment that what was seen initially, Trump was seen as summer theater when this whole thing started.
A summer fling.
A summer fling. It's not a fling anymore.
All right, let's, you know, with all due respect, I have called him over the last few months the clown car of candidates, because every time you open the door, one of them pops out. I'm
mm-hmm.
not calling them clowns, just the volume of them. So let's take a little look at the some of the highlights from the debate of this past week, and we'll comment when we come back. Okay, it's not ready. That's the beauty of live television. But you saw it. I saw especially that Cruz was going after Rubio and vice versa.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And apparently they're trying to be the anti-Trump or just be on the lower level when Trump implodes if he does. What's your take on that?
A different view of this. I think Trump's going to win. I really do. I think he's got such momentum, and that the people behind him are passionate, whereas the people behind the other candidates are not that passionate. So it matters who shows up at these
things. That's the thing, Jordan. Who votes? Passion really makes a difference.
Sure. In the Iowa caucuses in the middle of January, who's going to go out in the cold and do it?
Right.
I think the other thing is you've got the whole issue with the caucus voters, who are one type of voter, and then the general audience out there, the general population vote. So, you know, you might
it's
win.
It's the committed who go out and vote.
All right, let's take a look at the clip, because I'm told now it's ready. So here we go. Let's take a look at the clip.
That we punched the Russians in the nose. They've gotten away with too much in this world.
Three times he voted against the Defense Authorization Act. And I have to assume that if you vote against it in the Senate, you would also veto it as president.
ISIS and radical Islamic terrorism will face no more determined foe.
People don't want to let people that want to kill us and kill our nation use our internet.
Donald Trump, a serious candidate.
Margaret Thatcher once said, if you want something talked about, ask a man. If you want something done, ask a woman.
It's the first time I've spoken, and several people have had multiple questions, so please try to pay attention to that.
If your eyes are glazing over like mine, this is what it's like to be on the floor of the United States Senate.
It's time that we punch the Russians in the nose. They've gotten away with
it. I was watching the debate, and I was watching this earlier today. It's almost like a bunch of kids in a schoolyard.
It is.
You know, Donald Trump's insulting him, he's insulting her, vice versa. Do you get that impression as well? I don't think there's much policy.
It's turning off voters. It's turning off voters.
You think so?
Because there are some serious issues that people have to be dealing with.
Let's talk about the economic issues of all this, even though this particular debate was on foreign policy.
So this week, the Federal Reserve raised interest rates for the first time in 10 years.
Which we're going to talk about in the next segment.
Okay. That is a problem for a lot of people, I think. They're going to be paying more in interest. Mm-hmm. The economy has been slowing even without the Fed raising rates. You're seeing even the housing and car markets, which have been pretty strong, weakening. People are worried about their jobs and about economic growth here, and that's not what they're talking about for the most part. It's the hot button issues. It's immigration, it's security, Muslims, all these kind of things. It's not as much what people are where they're at right now.
But I think you have a volatile combination, Jordan, which is why Trump, especially, and Cruz to a lesser extent, are exploiting this. Mm-hmm. You have economic insecurity on the part of lots of people, especially people, a lot of white males, frankly, whose educational levels may not have been that high, and who are fearing the fact that they're not close enough to retire. There's been some recent reports that the death rate among white males across this country in the 50s and so forth, that is a few years before they can obtain Social Security, is really rising at a time when mortality should be increasing in this country, or longevity rather. What's going on? These people are, frankly, they're committing suicide through slow death, through drug and alcohol abuse. So there's that thing, and then you've got the terrorism issue, where people are frankly just afraid to be in public. You put those two things together, and that's a volatile mix that Donald Trump and others are exploiting.
Jim, what are your clients talking about when they see you? You're dealing with their financial investments and financial planning and so on, and I'm assuming a lot of them are in their 40s and 50s. What are their concerns? Do they like Trump, don't like Trump? Do they like the policies? Are they paying attention?
Well, I try and stay out of politics when it comes to dealing with my clients, or stay as neutral as possible. I think there's the polarized camps. There's either they love Trump or they hate them. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, they think he's a psychopath, or they think he's, you know, going to do all these.
But are
things.
They concerned about where everything is going?
They're concerned
on
about the country. Sure, I mean, they're concerned about, and they've been that way for a long time, Frank. Mm-hmm. I mean, this past few months ago, a couple weeks back, they actually passed a budget bill, which they hadn't done without it coming up to the or shutting down the government, which they hadn't done in like 4 or 5 years until they came right to the 11th hour or beyond in some cases. So, you know, that was a positive to me, that there was at least a little bit of functionality going on in Congress over the last few weeks, which has sort of not been in the news because of all the campaigning that's going on around the future presidency, right? You know, one sense, older clients are concerned because the low interest rates have hurt them in terms of CD rates. They can't live on safe investments like they used to, because the interest rates just aren't there for them to do that. On the other hand, you know, on the younger working population, there are jobs are there. I mean, people are changing jobs. My daughter just left a job. I had clients who've left jobs without even having another job, confident enough that they would find another job.
And that hasn't happened in years.
Many, many years. Mm-hmm. You're also finding people are able to negotiate for higher salaries. I mean, there isn't a lot of wage inflation right now in the numbers, but clearly the capacity is there. I mean, the job numbers continue to be strong.
Now, you're painting a rosy picture, and my friend here, Jordan Goodman, and we've had discussions about this,
there are underlying problems, according to Jordan, and maybe it's not as rosy as
it Look what happened to oil this week. Okay, oil's down to $34 a barrel. That's telling you.
And we thought 40 was the bottom.
Yeah, and it's been plummeting, and that's been bringing the stock market. Stock market's down sharply this week.
Why do you think the candidates are not discussing this?
They don't know what to do about it, basically. You know,
and I mean, in general, the economy.
Well, I mean, there have been other debates where they've talked about the economy a little bit, but I don't think they're dealing with the fundamental, what I think are deflationary forces, not only domestically, but worldwide.
They don't deal with the real issues. They deal with issues on the margins. They focus on abortion, for example. Yeah. They focus on issues of race and ethnicity. Right. They demonize people. I mean, this is what's got, frankly, people concerned in terms of the establishment of the Republican Party, believe it or not. They created this Frankenstein monster, and now they're having to deal with it.
And ultimately, they talk about, as you pointed out, whatever's the hot topic. Yeah. I mean, and some of that, again, is driven by the media. Sure. I mean, CNN could have certainly included some commentary or some questions in the debate the other night about something other than foreign
policy. Although I think the debate was supposed to be on foreign policy.
It may have been, but
they could have thrown
clearly,
a couple in.
Yeah, right.
Let's flip it and talk about the Democrats, if we may. They have a debate upcoming. Hillary Clinton well ahead in many of the national polls, mm-hmm. at least, but Bernie Sanders, a little scandal involving Bernie Sanders this week, and then you have Martin O'Malley, who's somewhere out in the weeds, hoping to become relevant. What do you see? Let's start with you. What do you see happening at this debate?
I'd like to just say that I think you've got a very interesting dynamic going on with the Republican National Committee. Their issue is that they've lost control of the process. Mm-hmm. The Democratic National Committee is involved in hyper-control. Yeah. They knocked Larry Lessig. I don't know if you know that name, but he was going to be the fourth candidate on the debates. They knocked him off the platform because they changed the rules midstream, said he didn't poll enough in order to qualify after they said they established a standard that would allow it. This week, they created a tempest in the teapot. Yeah, there was a problem. Was obviously some problem with the Sanders campaign, but they basically closed down their access to the database for 24 hours. I understand they've lifted it again, but it was a public display of control. Again, it was frankly.
I think there was the threat of they actually filed the lawsuit, Sanders campaign.
You can't function in a political environment if you don't have voter data today. I mean, that's the lifeblood or the oxygen of a campaign.
You talk about brokered convention for the Republicans. It could be brokered maybe for the Democrats as well, because a lot of people don't like Hillary Clinton. We have 1 minute left.
I think it's a coronation, frankly.
A coronation, okay.
Unless she gets indicted, which is possible, but considering the White House, probably that she won't be, but there are grounds that she violated all kinds of classified documents.
Jim, 30 seconds. Your clients probably perceive the Democrats as more tax and spend, and their investments won't do as well. Is that what they tell you?
There's a general concern over that. I think, for the most part, my clients would like to see us come more towards the middle from both sides, because compromise
hasn't happened in a very long
time. Right, there is no middle, but compromise is how you're going to get things to move forward.
You know, and I think a good sign of that was the budget that was reached, where
exactly,
we actually had some sort of
bipartisan. And that's why it wasn't in the news.
Yeah. Okay, gentlemen, thank you. When Fresh Outlook continues, the Federal Reserve, which Jordan mentioned a moment ago, finally pulls the trigger and raises interest rates. What it all means to the global economy and anyone borrowing money when we come back.